Let's see. Anonymous says, why is early morning waking a characteristic symptom of depression? And what other conditions and imbalances of early waking as a symptom?
I know this answer.
Oh.
Cool. Do you know the answer?
I do, well, I might, but let me, I'm not going to guess your answer. I want to hear your answer.
When you have, so the early morning waking, when you wake up in the morning, let me just start there. It's called the cortisol awakening response. We shorten it to the CAR, cortisol awakening response. And it's a it's historically a non-stress driven natural rise in cortisol. Researchers aren't 100% sure, other than maybe for survival. So when you wake up in the morning, you want to be alert, you need to be conscious, you need to be ready to go just in case there's, you know, bad things around you that, and you've been asleep. But we do know the cortisol awakening response. It happens in about the first 30 to 60 minutes of your day. Literally from the time your eyes open, your cortisol should shoot up to a point and then gradually come down for the rest of the day. Now with depression, it's heavily studied. If you have an elevated or excessive cortisol awakening response, meaning you go higher, your spike is higher and more dramatic than the average bear, then your risk for morning depression is much higher. And the reason for that is we've already touched upon with estrogen and the serotonin versus kynurenine pathway, because high excessive glucocorticoids or cortisol can also upregulate the pathway away from serotonin and down towards kynurenine. And so if you wake up with excessive amounts of cortisol, for whatever reason, you're stressed out, you're anticipating your day, you wake up in pain, you wake up with inflammation, you know, something startled you awake, like your kid is throwing up. It can increase your risk for morning depression because it pushes that, all that excessive cortisol pushes your tryptophan away from serotonin and down towards kynurenine. And then, as Chris said, if you are going down the kynurenine pathway and you already have issues with that, you can make that quinolinate, which is a neurotoxin as well. So now you have less serotonin and more quinolinic acid, which is neurotoxin. And now you've got potentially this double whammy, if not a single whammy, against you. So that's one of the big, when they do the research on morning depression, it's one of the big things they're studying is the excessiveness of your cortisol awakening response in the morning. Are you a hyper person? Are you normal or are you flatlined? Do you go down? And then if you go down, that's a whole different thing. That does all sorts of other stuff.
Mm.
Were you going to say something different?
No, I didn't know that. I'll throw out a couple other things that I think could theoretically be an issue. So, I mean, in addition to the glucocorticoids influencing where tryptophan goes, I have a sneaking suspicion, and I don't have good data supporting this, but it just makes sense to me, and it seems to make sense with some people's anecdotal stories. I think that part of the half-life of melatonin is really short, and you have to produce it all night long, basically. And I think that.
And you mean pineal, right? Not gut. In this context, you're talking pineal.
And so it can definitely be a limiting factor in onset insomnia not to have enough melatonin. And one of the things that can limit that is getting tryptophan into the brain. And tryptophan gets into the brain mainly as a result of the ratio between tryptophan and competing amino acids in the blood. And the best ways to increase that are to either take tryptophan in an empty stomach, or to eat a meal with high glycemic carbs, or to exercise. And if not having enough tryptophan entering into the brain can be a limiting factor for onset insomnia, it just seems logical to me that if you didn't get enough tryptophan into the brain to make enough melatonin precursor to keep synthesizing melatonin through the night for 8 hours, basically, that it could also be a factor in how long you stay asleep. Mm-hmm. And so I think that, I think this is true for some people because I know people that can't sleep through the night unless they take 10 milligrams of melatonin before mm-hmm. they go to bed. Right. Mm-hmm. And yeah. so clearly they're, and what makes them fall asleep if they do wake up and they don't take the melatonin is eating, especially carbs.
Especially carbs. Yeah.
Right. And so that lines up very nicely with, they're getting melatonin precursor stored in their brain, but just maybe only 4 hours worth. Mm-hmm. And then they need to get another 4 hour dose of it. Whereas, if they take 10 milligrams of melatonin, then for some reason, the absorption from the gut slows a lot when you have a higher dose. I guess the absorption must be saturated or something, because the curve in the blood, the half-life in the blood just gets, I don't know if it's the half-life of the individual molecule, but like the, if you take a really large dose of melatonin, you can stretch out the peak curve and how long it lasts, right. like across the whole night, basically, even if it's not time release. And so, I think that lines up there. I also think that there are some people, particularly people who do a lot of high intensity exercise and don't eat enough carbohydrate, who are not repleting their hepatic glycogen mm-hmm. before they go to bed. And so your liver has generally stored about 90 grams of glycogen for the purpose of maintaining your blood sugar between meals. The longest time that you ever go without a meal is overnight. And so that's when your liver has the biggest task ahead of it. It has even more of a task if you're practicing any kind of time-restricted feeding.
Right.
Quite often people who are practicing time-restricted feeding are also practicing high intensity exercise and are also practicing carbohydrate restriction. And so, you know, you might have a CrossFitter who eats 60 grams of carbs a day, is deliberately winding back the length of their evening meal to 4 p.m. and they don't know why they're waking up at 3 a.m. with their heart pounding every mm-hmm. day. And I think that's because they're getting an adrenaline and cortisol response.
And they're irritable.
Yeah.
They're always angry and irritable and snippy. Yeah.
And so I think that can be a big issue for people who are early awakening as well. And if you think of both of those conditions, if you're not eating enough carbohydrate to keep your liver glycogen full, you're probably not getting enough to get tryptophan into your brain. And if you're not getting enough tryptophan in your brain to make melatonin all night, you're probably not getting enough tryptophan in your brain to make serotonin either.
Right.
So all of those could kind of feed into the same mechanism that you were describing with the glucocorticoid suppression of serotonin levels. So I think that's a couple more things that
we could add. Oh, for sure. Yeah.
Cool. Thank you for your question, Anonymous.